Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm getting ready to leave out here, but the Lord really pressed me last night. The Lord just keeps dropping these awesome messages to me. I'll try my best to do it here. You know, if you've been watching my videos, I've been doing all these videos about the duality of the natural versus the spiritual. You know, Jesus was God, yet he was man. The duality of the evilness of this world, whereas, as an example, in all things like alcohol, the duality of the commercial of you know, young people, you know, out there with a bunch of, you know, bikini clad models playing volleyball and drinking Budweiser, and then the reality of the duality that the end result is, you know, DWIs, car wreck and killing somebody, cirrhosis of the liver, death, and, you know, just in the flesh. And then the duality of the fact that in the flesh you can get sicknesses and diseases and get into all kinds of trouble. And then the duality and the reality in the spirit realm that you would end up in hell as a drunkard. For the Bible says no drunkard will enter the kingdom of heaven, brothers and sisters. So we see all these dualities and all these different levels. But what I want to talk to you right now about that topic, the Lord just keeps leading me on that topic, brothers and sisters, is the duality of Israel and the church. The duality of the spirit man and the flesh man. Brothers and sisters, why the Lord led me on this topic last night after I made those videos, and I was thinking about the, you know, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and how I said in the video, there's some Christians who want to be Judaizers, or, you know, yeah, they want to bring the law into the church, which the whole New Testament is about how the law is not part of the church. Acts chapter 15 is probably the best example when the apostles met in Jerusalem and discussed this topic. Do the Gentiles need to keep the law or not? And the answer is given in Acts chapter 15. No, we do not. So it's by grace we are saved through faith. This came from Peter and James, the half-brother of Jesus, also said this, who wrote the book of James in the New Testament. And of course, Peter, you know. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the duality of this, Jesus, as I've said before, which is true, the duality that Jesus was God, yet a man. Now, after the resurrection, Jesus walked around in an earthly body. It says he gave up. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but gave up his, you know, his place as God and came to earth as a man, found himself, you know, as a man and lived as a man. And then when Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit came on him. Jesus operated as a spirit-filled Christian. He set the way of what it's like to operate as a man filled with the power of God. Now, he didn't operate as God, for he could have destroyed Satan. He could have stopped his crucifixion. He could have done all those things, but he didn't. He operated as a spirit-filled man. When he dealt with Satan, he used the sword of the Spirit. Talk about the armor of God, Ephesians chapter 6. The greatest example is our Lord when he was tempted in the wilderness. The Lord is our perfect standard. Not Paul, not Peter, not any of those guys. All men fail. All have fallen short of the glory of God. All have sinned and fallen short. That includes Peter, Paul, all the people in the Bible. Moses, whom lots of people are worshiping, these, you know, people from the Bible, whether it be Mama Mary, Abraham, any of these people. None were perfect. They all sinned. None is righteous. No, not one. Only the Lord Jesus Christ. He is what the Bible calls the second Adam. Adam failed. Jesus finished and did what Adam didn't do. That was to live and obey the commandments of God and finish the race and be sinless. That was Christ, and offer himself as a living sacrifice in the place of our sins. He himself became our sin. He's our sacrifice. He took our place on the cross. For God told Adam and Eve, the wages, you know, the day you eat the fruit, you'll die. And the wages of sin is death, but the gift is God, of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Bible tells us. So Jesus, after his resurrection, brothers and sisters, I want to talk about the duality of the resurrection, besides all these other things too. And that's the main point. A lot of times people, you know, some people think, oh, Brother Patrick, you're going to know. It's always about Jesus. It's always about his atonement for us. It's always about the cross. It's always about Jesus Christ and him crucified. Any topic always comes back to the gospel. That's what's wrong with these modern, you know, alleged revivals. When you see Todd Bentley and those people, they have some kind of revival. They're not talking about Jesus. Todd Bentley said his purpose was to bring people to know about some angel named Emma. You know, the end of all preaching and everything people do should always lead to the gospel message, the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the opportunity to be pardoned, forgiven of our sin, and become born again. As Jesus said, John chapter 3:3, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So, brothers and sisters, it's always the center of everything that I do. It always loops back across that. It's like the middle of Interstate 35, I-35, Isaiah 35, the highway of holiness. That's where we need to be. And the center of that road is always the cross of Christ. Even though I may run out to the four points of the cross and talk about the earth at the bottom, heavenly things in the top, walking in holiness on one side, but yet we have grace on the other side of the cross and those horizontal ways. But it always comes back to the center of where is the Lord Jesus Christ offered himself as a living sacrifice for us and gave up the ghost, laid down his life for us. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. Praise God for that, brothers and sisters. So, after the Lord was resurrected, he was able to walk through walls, but yet he was able to eat. He brought together, brothers and sisters, and that's what the Lord wants me to talk to you about. I need to talk about Israel and the church too, but becoming one new man. But the one new man in the flesh, like I said, everything that God did with Israel is in the flesh. Abraham's natural seed was Isaac. The natural seed, Jacob. Then the 12 tribes of Israel. The 144,000 witnesses out of that. This is the natural seed of Abraham. But the Bible tells us, that's why people get confused about following the law and all that. It's just so simply laid out in the New Testament. We are the adopted sons of God, the spiritual seed of Abraham. The church is spiritual. Israel is the natural. Jesus came to Israel is in the flesh, in the natural. Born of a woman, Mary. Came as a man living in the flesh. He was raised as a human. You know, Jesus slept. As the Bible tells us, he slept on the boat when the storm came. He ate. He went to the bathroom. He did all those things that all people do in the natural way. But yet he didn't ever sin. He was tempted in every way, but without sin, as the Bible says. But when after his resurrection, you know, he brought that spirit, the spiritual thing together in the natural. And the resurrection, brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to get to is we, you know, the Lord just dropped this on me last night. This is actually an awesome message for serious Christians, you know, people that are deep into the Word. This is an awesome message. You know, that Israel, the natural, the church, the spiritual, when they're brought together, as it says, as one new man, you know, that is symbolized by the resurrection. When we're resurrected, you know, our people that have died, they're in the spirit body in heaven. And those of us who are alive and remain, we're walking around in the flesh. But our spirit's been born again. You know, our spirit has become alive to God. When you get saved, you inherit eternal life. When the Bible talks about eternal life, people that are not saved still have eternal life. But life, when God says life, he means living with him and in the light and enjoying all that. Being in hell is death. It's a fate worse than death. That's why some of these people, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses and stuff, they talk about soul sleep. When people die, they're annihilatism. They cease to exist. They see that because the scripture talks about, you know, death. But death is being separated from God. It's being in the darkness. It's being in torment. It's being in hell. That's the, you know, the spiritual side of death. You know, the natural is you see someone, their heart's not beating. You know, they're not breathing. They're dead. But spiritually, you're either alive with God, eternal life, or an eternal death. You're eternally dying. That's why people say, oh, they're in hell. You know, and the Bible talks about they're having pain and suffering. They're dying, eternally dying. While we're in heaven, you know, the Lord is our sunshine. There is no sun. It's the sun, S-O-N, is our light there. And we're eternally living. So you imagine that just as someone in hell, God forbid anyone ever go there again, but we know that their people will always reject the Lord. There are some people who always reject the Lord, no matter what. You know, they're eternally suffering just as in heaven. We will be eternally blessed. We're eternally living more and more. Our life is growing as their death is growing. The people in hell. As above, so below. For God too, in the third heaven. Let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So when these things come together, brothers and sisters, the resurrection, just like when Jesus had his resurrected body, you're able to, you know, you're combining those earthly things like eating, and you can drink, you can walk around, you can talk to people, people can touch you, but yet walk through walls. You're bringing together. So this is the manifestation of what we see with a church and Israel too. The natural of the church and the spiritual, the natural of Israel and the spiritual of the church coming together, brothers and sisters, as one new man. That's what the first resurrection of the, aka the rapture, is the first resurrection. The second resurrection, or at the end of the tribulation period, brothers and sisters, Israel will accept the Lord, and those Israelis who are alive on earth and didn't take the mark, who accepted the Lord, they're in Petra and all those things. Those people will be walking around earth and living as humans. And then the second resurrection for the people who died and went to hell is at the end of the 1,000-year reign. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to want to get into all that theology. The point being, brothers and sisters, that the unity of Israel in the church is a mystery and a duality, just like when we're resurrected. Like when the Lord was resurrected, you have the natural man combined with the spirit man to become a total new creation in Christ, to be totally redeemed. Right now we're being redeemed. In the Greek, and what it even says in one of those texts, to those who are being saved, that's a proper way of saying we're in the process of being saved. Our spirits have been born again, but we're still on this earth. We're still walking around. You know, we still can sin. We still can get sick. We are still living in a fallen world. So our redemption is not complete. That's why Jesus said, know that your redemption draweth nigh. So we haven't been redeemed yet. But a deposit, as the Bible says, an earnest in the King James, like when you go buy a house, you put down a down payment. They call it an earnest. I make an offer on a house and I put down $1,000 or something. That's my earnest money. So the modern day word for that is a deposit. You make a deposit on it. So the King James uses that word that still used in the housing industry here where I'm from and real estate, put an earnest money, put down some money. So the Lord had put an earnest on us, and that's sealing us with His Holy Spirit when we got spiritually born again. But now when the rapture happens and the resurrection, which is the same, it is the same. Don't listen to any of these bizarre, wacky, you know, private interpretations about what the meaning of the Bible is. What I'm telling you is standard theology, standardly accepted by evangelicals and Pentecostal people, you know, thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands of pastors. You know, this is the understanding of the Word of God. Now, nobody's perfect, but let's stick with, let's learn, you know, the main understandings of pastors and doctors of theology, and then we can begin to examine where we think they might be wrong. Not got saved yesterday and then all this stuff is wrong the next day because you watched the video on YouTube. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so I didn't mean to get off on that, but it just come to my mind because there's always the bizarre opinion. But that doesn't mean that people aren't brothers and sisters in Christ. People can have bizarre beliefs about these kind of non-essential doctrines about the rapture. Is there a pre-tribulation rapture or not? That doesn't make someone not a Christian. Always had to throw that out there. But the problem is when those people with their bizarre beliefs try to say everybody else is wrong but them. You know, that's where cults are for. You know, when you get into this cultish ideas, you know, you've got this special revelation that no one else has, totally outside anything else and anybody else. His understanding. God normally doesn't operate that way. He normally uses his servants, preachers, and then he normally builds line upon line, precept upon precept, where, you know, God would reveal, you know, here a little, there a little, the Bible says. You know, we see through a glass darkly. He gave a little piece to me, a little piece to somebody else. And then, you know, throughout this, the whole world, there are his servants who are picking up these things and it comes together. That's how these things form, you know, a movement in the body of Christ as God is developing it through his people. That's how God normally operates, you know. Not some way doctrine far out of left field. Any idea you can think of, someone's already thought of it before. There's whole schools of thought at the beginning of the church age about all these different kinds of doctrines, brothers and sisters. If you go look at church history, you can see that there are whole schools of thought on all these different things like soul sleep that the Jehovah Witnesses have and all that way back in the beginning of the church age. And it was rejected as heresy in 200 BC, in 300 BC, and the church fathers wrote about it, and it was declared as they were declared heretics then. So, and then all these different beliefs, they've come up in the past and put aside as heresy, brothers and sisters. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. It's just, you know, I always try to not get into talking about these theology things, but the Lord always leads me, brothers and sisters, to, you know, to bring me on here is that the center of the road, you know, of the I-35, you know, let's try to hear from God. Let's try to, you know, hear different things on the outskirts of what God would be revealing to us. to add to what is known in the body of Christ, but let's keep it rooted and grounded in the Word. Let's make sure that it comes back to the center of the road, that it ties in with the, it's rooted and grounded in the Word of God. God bless you guys. I just want to say, too, that the video that I just made a little while ago, in the last videos I made where the Lord said that the harvest is Abib, I did not say that about the Jewish month of Abib is that the rapture is going to happen during that time. There's always people that just, you know, they're always thinking with their natural mind. I did not say that. Maybe that's what the Lord meant. I don't know. I can only say what the Lord gave me. Without, I didn't add to or take away from what the Lord told me. Just like when you read those prophecies in the Bible. They're, you know, they're ambiguous in a way. When then when the thing happens, you know, just like when Jesus walked the earth, brothers and sisters, it says that, you know, did anything good come out of Nazareth? Everybody kept saying, well, you know, there's no prophet that comes out of Nazareth, so Jesus can't be the Messiah. But yet they didn't know he was born in Bethlehem. But the Bible says, I called my son out of Egypt, Matthew tells us. So it's talking about Jesus. But if he was from, and then in Micah says he's supposed to be born in Bethlehem. So when Jesus came, he was from Nazareth. There, you know, nobody knew that, oh, his parents had went to Bethlehem for the census and he was born there. And then people didn't know that. That he was born in Bethlehem, fulfilling that prophecy. People didn't know his family fled into Egypt, then he came back, fulfilling the prophecy that out of Egypt I called my son, as Matthew tells us. People didn't know that. It was not apparent until after the fact. And then Jesus, like at the end of the one of the Gospels, he opens the eyes of those disciples on the road to Emmaus and explained the scripture to them. He opened the scriptures to them so they could understand. So all these scriptures and people give a word from the Lord and all that, lots of times, you know, we can think it means one thing, and then when it happens, we say, oh, I thought it meant this, but actually it meant this, or it meant both. God does these things, and he does it on purpose. Why? Because Jesus keeps proclaiming, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. So God puts these things out, just like another duality, just like when someone speaks in tongues, and then you have an interpretation. When we're even speaking in regular words, there is a meaning in the natural, and then there's the spiritual meaning too. And there can be multiple meanings to the same word that the Lord gives us. And then when it happens, the Lord would quicken that word back to us. And remember that the Lord told us 10 years ago, ABC, and you didn't know what it meant. Boom, there's the answer now. So when the Lord told me that the harvest is Abib, to me it means the harvest is ready now. It doesn't necessarily mean in the month of Abib, in the time of the Passover. It could mean both of those things. I have no idea. I have no idea. So I want to say that, brothers and sisters, there's always people who run wild with these things. I've seen other people who made videos, and as you know, and people said, oh, they set a date when they didn't. I've heard what they said. They didn't set a date. They said what the Lord told them, and it could be interpreted to mean a certain time, like Pentecost or Feast of Trumpets or whatever. Some people ran wild with it. And then when it didn't happen, they said, oh, this is a false prophecy. No, no. You chose to hear what you wanted to hear and not hear with a spirit ear. You heard with your natural ear and ran wild with it and received what you wanted to receive. You took the inference, is the $5 word. You inferred something that you thought someone was implying to you, when in reality, that is not what the Lord was saying. And God always speaks. Jesus never spoke except for in parables to the people. And then for he who has an ear, let him hear. God bless you guys. May the Lord be with you.